Hi everyone, welcome to the show. AMC shares are racing to the stars. Pot stocks rally on Amazon news, somehow backing the cannabis legalization, and Tesla loses market share globally. AMC is now worth more than half the companies in the S&P 500 is a major headline on Bloomberg News today, and it's of course not normal. So quickly, there is not much happening in the market overall right now. On the index level, trading is fairly flat. The US major indices ended Wednesday's session near zero, slightly but very slightly positive though. Activity in US futures hint at nothing major in today's session at the time I'm recording this show, and I expect to see very limited price action into Friday's US jobs data. But the Reddit Wall Street Bets short squeeze frenzy is pushing the trading in AMC shares to a new level, and there are many, many questions about how far this rally could go so rapidly. AMC is a movie theater chain. It's a money losing movie theater chain, obviously having got a massive hit from the pandemic lockdown. So one particularity of AMC as GameStop is that these stocks are or were heavily shorted by Wall Street investors in the past, as they bet that these businesses would go bust at some point. That was before the Wall Street Bets army came in charge and sent the share prices of these companies to an unprecedented rally. So AMC went from a failing small cap business to a, from a stock price standpoint, of course, a flourishing big cap in a couple of months only. Well, fundamentally, we know that that's not the case. We know that AMC is not a flourishing business, or at least not for now. And in my opinion, there is quite little chance that the actual and future business environment in the movie theater business would ever justify a $33 billion US dollar worth of market capitalization, unless there is an incredible innovation in the movie theater business that no one has heard of and which would change the face of the business moving forward. So I received a couple of questions that I believe are worth to have a look at. So the number one is how long the rally could last. Well, it could last as long as small or big traders obviously continue co-buying the AMC shares. So here the co-action is key. That's exactly what keeps the rally together. The problem here is the higher the price, the higher the temptation to take profit and walk away. So is the price high enough right now? Well, relatively speaking, it is. The AMC's share price is at a record high. Only yesterday, the stock was up by 127% at some point, and the total gains shot up to 3,000% this year only. So trend and momentum indicators are flashy red, obviously. Rationally speaking, the only possible direction from here is an as impressive downside correction. But for Wall Street bettors, the price target is 500,000, and the hashtag AMC500,000 is what's trending on social media platforms. Could it be? Well, I want to believe no, but AMC is up 8% in the after hours trading, so some couldn't have enough of yesterday's rally, obviously. Now, another question is whether Modric news, so news that the fund bought and dumped some 8.5 million shares, could have an impact, and what kind of impact? Well, the knee-jerk reaction to the Modric news wasn't bad at all. In fact, Modric dumping the shares only revived the pajama traders' ambition to go against these walls of Wall Street, and that's maybe what triggered the additional rally that we've seen at yesterday's session. But it looks like the Wall Street won't let the AMC shares slip by so easily, as the short positions keep on coming back, and the higher the price, the higher the gains on a short trade, potential of gains on a short trade. But you know, still be careful with a short position, especially in such a wild market environment, as losses in a short trade are simply unlimited. So I would recommend that if you take a long or especially a short position in AMC, then don't let your positions run without an adequate stop loss strategy. That's very, very important. Now, Another place where the price action is worth having a look at is the pot stocks. Tilray was up near 12% yesterday, Aurora rallied some 8%, and Canopy growth rebounded past 5% a day after announcing worse than expected first quarter results. Now, we've been seeing an improved interest in these cannabis stocks since a week now, and news that the cannabis legalization efforts won another and a big backer called Amazon certainly helped pushing the pot stocks higher yesterday. So Amazon said it won't screen its workers for the drug except for positions subject to regulation, of course, like drivers, for example, or in case of an incident. And there won't be screening before recruitment. So those are a small step for pot consumers, obviously, but a big step for regulation. And it looks like the rally that we see in these pot stocks is gaining momentum, and there are gains to be made in the short and medium run, probably. From a technical standpoint, for many of these stocks, the RSI index doesn't necessarily point at overbought market conditions just yet. So the price pullbacks could actually be interesting opportunities to strengthen long positions. Aurora hit the $10 mark for the first time since March, and taking out the 100-day moving average near this level should back a further advance towards the $11.50-$12 area. Canopy should test the $28 per share mark, and we shall see. Tilray targeting its 100-day moving average, which stands a touch above the $21 mark, for the next couple of trading sessions. Other interesting pot names are Hexo, Kronos, which is owned by Philip Morris Altria, and 22nd Century Group, which is among the top picks at Swissquote, and which actually has a relatively more stable upside trend compared to the other star names as Tilray or Canopy, for example. Elsewhere, crude oil continues pushing higher, and the US crude is now preparing to take out the $70 per barrel level. So the firming oil prices push energy stocks higher as well. We saw another 2% rise in BP yesterday, which is now testing the May resistance, and if successfully pulled out, should pave the way to the 350p mark. Exxon, on the other hand, is still dealing with the green activist and engine number one, which wants to see Exxon pulling away from fossil fuel, has just won a third seat on Exxon's board for now. And so far this week, the investor appetite hasn't been bad in Exxon, and Exxon remains a solid reflation play, and the board reshuffle we see nowadays should not be a harmful news in the medium to long run, when the oil giants are left with no choice but to adapt to the new world priorities, and the climate change comes obviously on top of that list. Now, remember also that Exxon is pointed as a top major ID at Bank of America, whose price target stands at a distant $90 per share for Exxon. Now, a quick word on Tesla before we move to the macroeconomic calendar of today. Tesla made a U-turn and returned to its 200-day moving average, which is a touch above the $600 mark, after the latest data showed a loss of global market share for the company in April. Well, we know that the competition in the EV sector is getting tough, and Tesla will be facing more and more of these rising competition and falling market share issues moving forward. That's nothing new. Now, yesterday's price action come as a threat to my short-term bullish target of $660 per share still, and I will drop that bullish call if we see a further decline to the $570 per share level. Now, last but not least, the US will review its latest ADP employment report today, and according to a consensus of analyst estimates, the US economy may have added some 645,000 new private jobs in May versus 742,000 printed a month earlier. So keep in mind that the actual data tends to be quite far from the estimates nowadays, as the pandemic uncertainties give little framework to analysts to form their predictions. So there is a chance that we see a number that is meaningfully higher or meaningfully lower than the consensus figure. Now, two things to keep in mind. First, a strong read will likely fuel inflation worries across the board, and the discussion that the Federal Reserve should start thinking about tapering its massive bond purchases in order to prevent the US economy from overheating, and that could weigh on investor sentiment globally speaking. And second, there is not a meaningful correlation between the ADP and the NFP numbers. So last month, for example, we saw a better than expected ADP read versus a much, much worse than expected NFP print. So even though the ADP figure will give a certain bias, positive or negative bias, to the investor sentiment into Friday's jobs figures, we actually could see any surprise on the NFP front tomorrow. And that's exactly why I believe that on the index level, we will hardly see a remarkable, a meaningful price action before tomorrow's jobs figures in the US. This is all for today. I'm Ipek Ozkardeskaya, and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and insightful to you. Please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your questions, and your reactions below, and also follow us on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.